The views, comments, and opinions of the following program do not necessarily reflect those of Morris Media Studios, MorrisMediaLive.com, or its affiliates. Listener discretion is advised.
Well, hello, everybody, and welcome to the Ride Along Radio Show, the resurgence of the Ride Along Radio Show. Those who've been watching for a while know that I'm George Holt, and there's been a change of personnel. So I actually have a new co-host here next to me, who's a guy I've been trying to get on the show for a while, and he's here, and I'm going to let Mike Dowd introduce himself.
Well, you just did, George. I'm Mike Dowd. My claim to fame is I'm known to be part of the dirtiest cop organization in the 75th Precinct in East New York, Brooklyn, back in the NYPD, back in the 1980s. And, you know, we've had a new look at new lease on life. And
right.
George and I are looking to do a little, be informative.
That's right.
And break down some stuff that you people may or may not understand the perspective that we both have from our experiences.
And the perspective, and as always on the Ride Along Radio Show, our whole goal was to provide you with a ride along in a virtual police car where we kind of look at some stories of the day, news stories, current events, etc., and give you a perspective that you may not have. And Mike is able to offer some perspective that I have and some perspective that I don't have, right? So I think you're going to see some worthwhile contributions here tonight in terms of how we approach these things and what it is that we talk about. And, you know, people, given our backgrounds, and we've had this conversation before. In fact, I think it was one of our first conversations where we talked about it's kind of a good cop, bad cop vibe. But if you you may listen to me and some of my social views, and you may listen to Mike and some of his social views, and depending on where you fall on the spectrum, you may be asking yourself, who's a good cop, who's a bad cop? Right.
Just well, we hope he can pull that off.
Right. Right. So let's see. Right. You may. I think we got something for everybody.
Yeah.
Really.
Oh, this should be exciting. I can't wait to get going.
Yeah. It's
going to
be some good stuff, man. Yeah. So one of the things that we cover here is any law changes or upcoming changes in the law or predicted changes in the law. And right off the bat, and I don't want to jump into it too quickly, but I think we do need to get into this, talk about it. Apparently, the House of Representatives had planned on voting to legalize, or not legalize, there's a difference, to decriminalize marijuana on a federal level. And they decided to push the vote past the election. They were originally going to do it September 21st. And then they decided, you know what, we're going to wait till after the election, because they're expecting, you know, possibly a different Senate, different members of the House, et cetera, after the election, because some people are for election, some people not, whatever, right? So they decided to push it. And, of course, you know, the House Democrats are hoping for a new president after November. So so they're waiting to vote on that.
Hoping is the key word. Go ahead.
Right. Hey, hope is not a strategy, but, you know, and we used to say hope in one hand, crap in the other one, and see which one fills up first, right?
There you go.
But yeah. And I say crap because, you know, it's kind of a family show. Not really, but yeah. Whatever. So
if we slip a few F-bombs, is that okay?
Oh, fuck yeah.
Okay. Right. Although just half my vocabulary would be gone.
Right, there you go. That was half my act.
Yeah,
right,
yeah.
Right there, right?
So hopefully we could, you know.
Yeah.
I don't want to offend anybody. That's
listen,
part of,
if you know. If you are easily offended or you're quick to clutch your pearls.
To go.
Then, yeah, you this may not be the show
right.
for you. That's all I'm going to say.
One of the things that you pointed out, and I'd like to hit on real quickly before
sure.
we go further, is the when you say the House of Representatives, I looked at it from the perspective that they don't want to be on the record voting for or against this right now as the election approaches.
That's,
because
yeah.
what I feel they'll do is then they don't have to be take account. They don't have to be held accountable for right. either being pro decriminalization or against decriminalization.
Well,
I think it's going to pass easily anyway, by the way. That's my opinion.
Well, see, that's a different perspective, because I looked at it as they were, well, let's just wait and see what everybody's going to say. No. You're right. They
that's
could be
I
looking to escape accountability, too.
Right.
Or at least some of them
are. That's
what
they do.
If they're in a tough race. Absolutely, right?
Most of them want to escape. Who wants to be accountable for something if they don't have to, right?
Right. We can just table it and kick the can down the road like everybody else.
Right.
That's what they're going to do.
On November 5th or 6th, they can
then
vote.
Let's talk about it now, November 5th, right?
Yeah, right.
Right. Whatever.
Yeah,
you're right. That's a great point.
That's how I see it.
Yeah, because it's a hot-button item. And we have the video queued up, and then we can get into why we think it's probably going to pass, because I agree with you.
It's being called a landmark bill, a move to potentially decriminalize marijuana at the federal level. For the first time ever, it passed a congressional committee, which means the full House of Representatives will vote on the bill this September. Now, one big thing the Marijuana Opportunity Reinvestment and Expungement Act would do, remove marijuana as a Schedule I substance. That category currently features other drugs like heroin, LSD, and ecstasy. It would also erase the records of people with prior marijuana convictions, similar to what Virginia passed this year. And it would also include a 5% tax on marijuana sales. And according to the bill's text, that money would be reinvested in communities most affected by the war on drugs. States will still have the power to determine their own cannabis laws, but proponents of the reform say it's going to update federal laws to reflect popular opinion. According to two separate polls from Gallup and the Pew Research Center, about two-thirds of Americans support legalizing marijuana. 33 states and Washington, D.C. have legalized medical marijuana, and two more, Arizona and New Jersey, have initiatives on the November ballot. If the MORE Act passes the House, it'll head to the Senate with its lead sponsor, California Senator and Democratic Vice Presidential nominee Kamala Harris. For 13 News Now, I'm Philip Townsend.
All right. So, in the piece just now, they said that two-thirds of people support that. And so what you were saying, you know, that it probably is going to something they're going to pass just based on what people are willing to accept or willing to engage them in themselves.
I'm fucking ecstatic, okay?
Are you?
I'm ecstatic.
Okay, lay it out.
This is a bunch of bullshit, okay? I spent, as you don't know yet, but I spent 12 and a half out of a 14-year federal prison sentence in prison and deserved it, okay? I deserved what I did. I got what I got, and I deserved the time I got. Some people say I should have got life. Some people say I should have got less.
Okay.
Like Giuliani says I should have got life, you know, and
okay,
others.
Okay.
Everybody has their opinion.
Sure.
The facts are what they are. But I didn't deserve it according to the federal sentencing guidelines. So
here it is.
So, but the thing is this, and I'll just put this out there, and I don't want to get too far in the woods. I met people in federal prison that were doing 35 years, 40-year sentences for marijuana.
Really?
And their mothers and fathers were doing it with them. I mean, families were in prison for growing marijuana.
Wow.
And I'm talking back, okay.
That's pretty harsh sentence.
So I was sentenced arrested in 92, sentenced in 94. So I met these people in 94 that were doing 35-year federal prison sentences for growing marijuana. And now that's fucking abhorrent. I mean, I'm straight
up.
I don't care. Because you're a plant. All right? Look, I'm not a proponent of drug use, although I've used a few in my lifetime. But I'm not, like, that's, whoever instituted laws of that nature, they belong in prison, straight up.
Well, you know, the fact that marijuana...
Not the cops who made the arrest, they're doing their job,
right? They're doing
their
job, right? So the fact that marijuana is a Schedule I narcotic, along with heroin and cocaine and LSD, et cetera, that blows my mind, because there's never been a time where anybody, I don't think, thought that marijuana was as harmful as heroin.
Ever.
Okay?
Never.
Ever. There's a... But, you know, part of it's propaganda, too. Back in the day, there was a movie called Reefer Madness, right? And Reefer Madness was about people smoking marijuana and going crazy, as if it were like PCP, angel dust, or whatever, where people did really smoke it and lose their minds, right? And one of the taglines from a movie poster I saw, I'll never forget it, it said, the weed with roots in hell. and they showed like the plant coming up out of the ground and then the subterranean cut on the side and the roots were going down with the devil and all that, right?
Yeah, like, yeah.
Right, the devil's tobacco, you heard it called, and
yeah,
whatever, right?
Yeah,
and it's really, really is something that's villainized for no good reason,
right?
Right? While alcohol was allowed to flourish, except, of course, during the Prohibition.
Right.
But you would have thought that the folly of Prohibition and how that turned out and how it gave rise to organized crime in this country,
right,
that they would have seen something different with that. In terms, for me, they can make every drug out there legal. And the reason I say that is we're not stopping anything. We're not seeing anything but the damaging effects of it. There is no, there's no incentive other than hitting rock bottom for someone to try to get clean.
Right.
And how many cops have died in the war on drugs? A lot.
Thousands?
A lot.
Yeah.
Right?
Never mind our country. Around the world.
Right. Just around the world.
Mexico's
right?
Mexico's probably lost 15, 20,000.
Oh, easily.
At least.
Easily.
Every weekend.
Yeah. Yeah, right? All the time. Right?
I mean, all day long.
Between cops and soldiers. And
Colombia.
And the level of corruption that we've seen come out of it being illegal, I would think that somebody would say, let's make this, at least this one thing, legal.
Yeah, so we probably could end this discussion right now. Unfortunately, we agree.
Right.
I mean,
but you know, it's okay.
No, no.
Because there's more.
Yeah.
No.
I'm teasing you. Because I have plenty to say about it. I mean, I was on both sides of this issue, right?
Sure.
You know, I was a young cop in Brooklyn back in the 80s. I was one of the first cops to find crack cocaine.
Oh, really?
We didn't know what it was.
Oh, sure.
We had no idea what it was.
Sure, brand new.
We knew it was a drug because people were standing there with money in their pocket and these plastic vials, you know. And,
sure.
And it looked like it could be cocaine, but we didn't know what it was.
Like it's rocked up, a different form.
Yeah,
you're looking for powder.
We used to the $50 tinfoil,
right,
rolled up tinfoil, you know, squared off nice. And, you know,
nice little bindle, right?
Yeah, right. Yeah, that's what we were used to. And all of a sudden, we find these little white things in vials. We figured it was cocaine, but no one told us or schooled us on it.
Right.
So we would just throw it out.
It's too new.
We threw it out.
You guys were on the front lines. Yeah, right. You didn't know what you were throwing out.
We have no idea. You know,
sure.
We found out what we were throwing out. We took it home. But that's beside the point. there's a reason I went to federal prison.
Right.
You know, but,
right.
But the point is that, no one knew what it was. When it hit us like, you know, like a brick wall, you know. And it took this. It took what was... Let's call it a fairly active policing situation to an extremely insane policing situation. You know, it went from
was where?
The 75 was East New York, Brooklyn, which showcases
Brooklyn. Okay,
yeah. So, and it's called Northern Brooklyn, even though it actually is in the southern part of Brooklyn. It was considered Brooklyn North, and so next door, my precinct, which is East New York, then it had Brownsville, and then after Brownsville, you had Bed-Stuy, and then Bushwick, and then Bed-Stuy.
Okay, yeah,
so it was a heavy drug infested to begin with, but mostly back then you had your powdered cocaine, which wasn't really big in urban ghettos.
Right, it wasn't.
Because it was expensive.
It was there, but it wasn't.
It was expensive.
Sure. Right.
Right. So you didn't run across voluminous amounts of street cocaine. And then this came along, and it was every corner, you know, and we were throwing it out.
You didn't know.
We didn't know. At some point, we began to because you could lock up anybody. Like, the arrests wouldn't end. So within 6 months, they were threatening us, the police officers, to not make arrests. Because
what do you mean, the administration?
Yeah, because they were overwhelming the system.
Oh, okay, but what are you supposed to do? And let's talk about that.
And henceforth, there you go.
Right.
Opportunities arose then. You know, I was asked to condone but not condone it. Right?
Just turn a blind eye.
Turn
see,
a blind
see
eye
and don't
to it.
See, sure.
See it, don't see it, and now you become part of the problem, right? Isn't that what happens in society? Is we become part of the problem when we allow it to fester and grow.
What you allow or what you tolerate, you encourage, basically, right? So
So
let me ask you this though.
So
I've never seen somebody so strung out on marijuana that they're walking down the street with no shoes and turning tricks for $2.
Neither have I.
Okay? So it never should have been.
And that was 10 years solid
in
Brooklyn.
That's what I'm saying, right? Yeah. And I cut my teeth as a police officer working in the housing projects in L.A. first 15 years of my career.
Right.
And I worked from Watts to East L.A. down to the harbor all the way up to the valley.
No one on marijuana was strung out.
I never saw somebody on marijuana
just saying, yes.
so strung out
right.
that they were as desperate as you see crack turn people into, or heroin.
Or heroin, right.
Right? I've seen heroin addicts with
or cocaine.
Right, or just powder cocaine.
Not quite as desperate, though, for some reason.
PCP. I saw it. I saw people on all of it.
Oh, yeah.
And I never saw anybody as bad off. And so it never made sense to me. And of course, by the time I came on the job, I went to the academy in 88, hit the streets in 89. So for me, marijuana had already been decriminalized from where it was
right.
in the early 70s, right. late 60s.
Right.
Now,
it was a different thing. Back in the 70s, it was the big thing.
It was
marijuana.
A big thing, right?
Yeah.
Exactly. So what they did was, and you know, urban legend is that a lot of these college educated kids, a lot of kids from these good quote unquote families, start getting felony arrests for marijuana.
Right.
And then they said, well, we got to do something about this.
Right.
So let's introduce this act to decriminalize marijuana
right.
to knock it down to a misdemeanor.
Which
unless,
many
you know,
many cities, but not all did.
Well, the state of California, I think, was a leader in that. Like, we are in a lot of stuff like that.
Yeah.
And now all of a sudden...
Left-leaning, liberal type stuff. They
exactly.
call it liberal, but I don't use the word liberal.
Well,
that
but
way.
You know what? At the time, Ronald Reagan had just been out of office, and I think Jerry Brown, who was the young hippie
right,
governor,
right,
for
right,
lack of
right,
a better
right,
term,
right.
Was the one responsible for signing that. But now these kids who their parents spent a fortune sending them to law school or sending them to Dartmouth or Stanford or whatever.
Now they have records. Yeah.
They got records.
Yeah.
So now we
got
to do something about that, roll
right.
that back.
Right.
And now this is what – so we saw that,
that
get decriminalized.
Answer. That was the answer.
That was the answer. But it still was illegal that you couldn't walk down the street smoking a joint. You
right.
couldn't just walk into a place like you can now
right.
and buy marijuana like you're buying a candy bar.
Right.
Right? And I think that there's models on this – planet before we even started doing it in California or places like Vegas where they have weed tourism.
Boston. I mean, Massachusetts.
Is it Massachusetts?
Yeah, sure.
There's been other countries where it's been legal. Everything's legal.
Yeah.
Pretty much.
Right.
Right. Right. So there's a model
and
to
there's
do,
no significant
to do this
increase
right.
or you know.
Right. But so what I said earlier about we've gotten the bad side of the of addiction, but we never got the revenue.
Right.
From it, right? Because Pablo Escobar wasn't
paying
no taxes.
Well, it's a one-way revenue. It was a revenue.
It was revenue, right. It was revenue.
One-way stream
right,
and
but it wasn't coming back.
And jobs. Police, jailers.
Oh, of course. Well, you know what? That's a good point. If
you
talk about that.
So it's an economy itself.
That whole complex that came with that.
Attorneys, judges.
That's a damn good point.
There's a huge amount that needed this drug war.
Damn,
needed
I never,
it.
You know, I never even looked at it that way, man. That's a good point. It was an industry in and of itself,
when I went
just
to,
fighting drugs.
Yeah, when I went to federal prison, it was 48,000 federal inmates. When I left, I want to say it was 120,000, right? Yeah. In 12 years, it more than doubled?
It almost tripled.
Tripled. Yeah, and then I would think today, and I could be wrong, but I know it's over 200. It was. At some point, it was over 200,000. So, and that was all basically related to taking... urban kids
right.
that were selling crack cocaine.
Right. Giving them all
and
longer
giving,
sentences.
And giving them ass loads of time. I mean, okay, so I'll give you an example.
Okay.
I'm sitting in a visiting room in MCC New York. I'm facing life. Because everybody goes in, by the way, everybody goes into federal prison just about facing life, okay? Because
and
when you get arrested,
get it down.
When you get arrested in the feds, many of the drug-related crimes carry life.
Okay.
On them. So I'm facing 10 to life when I walk in the door.
On the back end, top end of it.
Yeah, top end of life, yeah. So, I don't think I'm really that bad of a guy. I did something foolish is what I'm thinking, right? You know?
Right. Right? It hasn't fully hit you yet.
Yeah,
probably.
I don't think that what they think about me, right? Who does, right?
Right, that's true.
I mean, so I think I'm not that bad of a guy. So I'm getting a visit from family members, and my parents are in there one day, and there's a Hispanic guy in there, and everybody in there, when they're taken away from their actions and activities, they become human again, right? Because
sure.
they're away from their addiction, whether it's money, power, drugs, behavior, right? And my parents are seeing this young guy there who's getting 45 years. Like, he's already copped a plea to 45.
Oh, yeah, he's already.
He's already copped a
he
plea.
He ain't facing it. He's going to
no,
go do it.
No, he's copped a plea to 45. I mean, he's 24 years old. He's 45 years.
He's done.
And my parents, who are good parents, right? They just raised 7 kids just for one fuck up. And they're looking at me saying, he's getting 45 years. He's such a nice guy. Now, we don't know really what he did.
We don't know what he did.
We don't know what he
did. There, sure.
But they see humanity.
All right.
And this is
so that dude's still in there is what you're telling me.
most people work their way out.
Okay.
Okay. You may cop to 45, but then, you know, you give up three of your friends, and then you get it down to 18. I see. Sure. You know, six and a half. You sure. know, so I mean, that's sure. how the feds work. But yeah, so it's an amazing system. I mean, everybody comes in facing life. So all those gangsters, you know.
Yeah, it falls apart.
Those
yeah.
gangsters don't really last very long when they're facing 10 and above. Okay, yeah. I'm just straight up.
We've seen that. And that's all gangsters of every stripe.
Right.
Those dudes fold faster than Superman's cape on laundry
get stitches,
day, man.
You know what?
They're done.
That's the program today. That's how it is.
Right.
I mean, I don't know today.
Even the wise guys accept that now, though. Even the wise guys accept that.
They come out, they do their thing, and then they become talk show hosts.
Right, exactly.
You know, I had a hard time getting one because I'm a cop, you know.
Right.
Ex-cop,
but Michael
whatever.
Francesi gets his.
Yeah, Mikey.
Yeah. Yeah. But so yeah, beside that industry there, there's tax revenue you could get if you were to legalize it, right? And you could clean up a lot of the violence because if Rite Aid is selling whatever it is.
Right.
Then Rite Aid's not going to shoot it out with CVS.
A 50 piece of right. heroin, cocaine, whatever.
Rite Aid ain't shooting it out with CVS. Right. That's not how they do business.
Right.
They handle it in the courts, right?
They type letters.
Right, exactly.
The pen. Huh? So the pen is mightier than the sword, right?
That's right. Yeah. You could clean up a lot of that related crime and see the revenue come back. Now, I will say this, though. We have seen it completely legalized in California. I mean, there's... under very rare circumstances, right, is anybody getting busted for marijuana.
Right.
And these dispensaries are paying their taxes, but the problem is that it's such a cost of doing business, and any business person wants to avoid those costs if at all they can. So you still have a lot of people who are low key selling weed unlicensed, right? But at least now, if you get caught doing that, it's a procedural. You're selling something without a license.
Well,
you're not going to get done for. Selling it.
Well,
you're getting done for selling it without a license.
You're speaking out of school. Don't we have somebody here that can actually...
We do. And after the break, when we get to the... we will bring him in, and I want to pick that up with him, too.
Okay.
Because for sure, like, he absolutely
knows. He knows exactly what's going on.
He absolutely knows, and he knows what's going on now. I've been away from it for a minute, too.
Yeah.
But in places like Las Vegas, there's weed tourism, where people can come in. They know now that it's legal.
Right.
So people are flying into Vegas to get high before they go back to Wichita or, you know, Sheboygan or wherever they came from, right?
Right.
And so
Are the police allowed to smoke in these locations?
See, now that's a good question. I do not know that.
And
because if it's legal.
And then ask yourself this question, which is a question I've often said to myself when I had nothing else to do. It's like, okay, so let's say they smoke a joint on the weekend.
Right.
And they go to work. And they get what they call a randomized drug test.
Sure, allegedly random.
Yeah. I've had a few randoms like week after week. But anyway, there's 42,000 cops every couple of weeks. I'm getting one. I don't know why. But yeah, so he's not high, right? I mean, 3 days ago. He's not high, right?
Right, because it's 3 days ago.
Yeah.
And so if he were to get in a shooting, it wouldn't be like the marijuana influence a person's judgment.
Right.
Well, the question is, do they even screen for that anymore? Because
there you go.
This is what I'm saying. So we have canines. I retired from the canine unit.
Right.
And my company now, we have a couple of dogs, right? And they're not drug dogs or bomb dogs.
Right.
But they have to train with the drug dogs. And now they're not even training dogs to detect marijuana anymore.
Well, I mean...
For what?
Yeah, you're
you know what I mean?
Time,
and the dogs that were trained on marijuana before, the older dogs, you got to proof them off of it now.
Right.
So that they, you know, they're not going to alert on it anymore. So.
Would they give them Suboxone?
I don't know what they give them. And I'm not even sure how they do it.
Anti-narcotic.
But there's a process to do that because we had to do that with the. Because what happens is a canine handler, when they go plant whatever it is they want the dog to find for training, canine handler's wearing latex gloves, right? Well, the dogs start associating that latex smell, so you have to proof them off the gloves.
Wow.
So they don't alert on the glove smell.
Right.
You teach the dog to ignore that smell. So it's the same thing, the process where they can get them off of the marijuana.
So if they toss my bags, I'm going to say it's plastic.
It's your rubber gloves.
It's your rubber glove.
It's your rubber gloves, man.
I said, that's a rubber glove they're hitting on, I swear.
But here's the other thing, too. And it makes you wonder, like, who is against legalizing marijuana? And my guess would be the cartels and all the other people who are profiting. The private prisons and all that, right?
Right.
But, you know, even though it's legal here statewide, what this federal thing would do is it would allow these guys who run these dispensaries, who run these all the pot shops.
To use banks.
They can use banks.
Yes.
And they can take credit cards.
Right.
And they can use other financial instruments that are controlled by the feds
right.
that right now they can't.
Because it's decriminalized.
You can't write a check. You yeah. can't use a debit card.
So all the holdup guys are going to go out of business.
They're going to, because you know you that a weed spot.
The weed spot's got cash.
These weed spots are sitting on cash.
Right.
And we've got, I've gotten hit up about, can your guys provide security for this weed convoy or this warehouse?
Which I used to do.
Weed and cash. Well, yeah, you used to do that on duty, though. Yeah. I was already retired when I got hit up yeah. about it. And it was legal. Yeah. But there's somewhere, as I'm speaking, somewhere that we probably drove by on the way here
undoubtedly.
Is a warehouse full of cash
right.
with dudes sitting there with rifles
right.
just Garden standing cash. By right. because they can't put it in the
they
bank.
Can't deposit
so
it.
All these guys can try to do is kind of do a soft laundering where they take that cash and then go buy a house
yeah.
or go buy an expensive car
yeah.
and then sell that. And right. now you can show the proceeds came from that or
right.
whatever.
Right.
But, you know,
I got a house
it's
to
a,
sell.
It's a big
so,
thing.
I mean,
do you? Okay, so there you go.
You can
if anybody's listening,
you can triple the
hit,
price.
Hit them up. Right, because they just want to get.
They just want to move the cash.
They want to move the cash, yeah. exactly. So that's the other thing that it would do. I don't see, except for some areas that have a lot of very older, conservative voters who are still buying into the weed with roots in hell thing.
Yeah, and you know, a lot of them are done hearing about it too.
You know what? And so let's talk about that. So like right now, if a person is 80 years old, right, that means. Because I just turned 55. I was born at 65.
Right.
Okay. So let's give somebody 20 years on me. 75-year-old person.
Right.
That dude was 20 in the 60s, man.
Right.
He's probably got a different view
yeah.
on marijuana than someone
who
from another generation was.
Well, he was poisoned by it?
Because he saw his friends do it. He probably did it.
Well, it's very...
Yeah. And so he's not looking at it like...
So my father's 80.
So he
and his friends.
Well, your father was a firefighter, though.
Yeah,
so that's
yeah,
a little
but some of his
different
friends would go skiing up in Hunter Mountain, and you know they hung out with all the nurses, all the firemen and the nurses, and they would smoke a joint here and there, and they were not like they would have looked at askance like, oh my God, but you'd hear about it. Oh yeah, they were smoking doobies.
Yeah,
they called them doobies, right? They were smoking doobies, you know. So it wasn't
doobie.
Like
I've heard that in a long time.
Yeah, they didn't. Well, that's. I'm old. Right. A little older than you, but not much. But I'm referring back to how my father would associate it,
sure.
you know? And you know, we would go, I would even discuss it with him back and forth, like even currently. And, you know, and I'll throw a name out there, like Bill O'Reilly.
Right.
He's like this anti-marijuana freak. And I respect, you know my views.
I respect
Bill O'Reilly. But shut the fuck up about marijuana, dude. It's over.
Yeah, he's not. But
the gig is up.
I don't know how old Bill O'Reilly is. But.
He's only maybe five years on me, six. Tops.
Okay,
it's over.
There's plenty of people who smoke marijuana regularly who are leading productive and full lives,
yeah.
and they're not letting their babies
starve
to death.
They don't
and
need
not,
OxyContin.
They're right.
They don't
exactly.
need OxyContin or anxiety pills. You know, I mean, so I mean, and that's something I've come to understand. I mean.
Well, it's better than pharmaceuticals, but that also may be why Big Pharma doesn't want to push.
Yeah, and I'm not a marijuana guy because, you know, I really don't want to. If you see him a little hyperactive to begin with, I prefer that rather than sleepy because that's what.
It might balance you out, though, from what I hear. Allegedly, that's what I heard. So listen, on that note, we're going to cut to a break. And when we come back, we're going to introduce our guest here. And we're going to get into this last discussion and we're going to jump on another topic, too. That our guest, who is a current officer, will have some input on. So we'll be right back.
Try to imagine a default, took the year like a bandit. Bought mama a crib and a brand new wagon. Now she hit the grocery shop looking lavish. Star Trek roof in the Wraith of Khan. Girls get loose when they hear the song. 100 on the dash, get me close to God. We don't pray for love, we just pray for cars. House so empty, need a centerpiece. 20 racks of table cut from ebony. Cut that ivory into skinny pieces. Then she clean up with her face, but I love my baby. You talking money, need a hearing aid. You talking about me, I don't see the shade. Switch on my side, I like to get any lane. I switch on my core if I can any pain. Look what you done.
Thanks, man. All right, and we're back. So before the break, we were talking about the federal efforts to decriminalize marijuana. And there is a difference between making something fully legal and decriminalizing it. And that's kind of a legalese or technical term, but there is a difference. And one of the things that Mike brought up was, hey, we got a guy sitting right here who was ready to jump in after the break, who is currently on the job, who can kind of speak to that. A little bit more on the impact
on the job. On I like drugs. How you adopted
it. Yeah, I got the New York thing on the job, right?
Yeah, I like that. Yeah, he's stepping it up.
He's on the jab. He's on the jab. Right? It's my New York accent. So so I'm going to pass it to my man, let him introduce himself and give a brief who he is and why you should care what he got to say.
Yeah, I appreciate the opportunity, George. My name is Knocko Nolan. I'm currently a detective sergeant on a major police department in Los Angeles, not too hard to figure out. And I had previous service on New York City Police Department.
That's right.
In Brooklyn, nice. North.
And you ran, why?
Nice.
Yes,
You didn't get jammed up, right?
No.
Okay.
Nice.
Okay.
Nice. Came for the sunshine.
Not too many guys have done it on both coasts, man. That's pretty cool.
Yeah.
Yeah, had the best of the worst worlds. So
That's great. That's great.
It was, yeah, a really good perspective.
How long were you out there?
I was there from 2000 to 2004.
Okay.
Yeah, so I came out here, checked into LAPD in 96, left in 2000, went back home to New York, and then came back out here again in 2004. So I jumped around a little bit.
Cool.
And but I worked in the adjoining precinct next to where Mike was in the 75. Uh-huh. It's called the A3 precinct in Bushwick, Brooklyn.
Okay. I never knew they worked the A3.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Wow. Yeah.
Cool, man. Now you have a very unique perspective. Oh, yeah, of course.
Yeah. Sure. Yeah. Yeah, you saw the end of the crack era, sort of, right? Just was it still?
Yeah, it's gentrified now.
Of course.
Like a lot
everything
of places
else.
Are.
Yeah.
So it's not violent anymore, thankfully.
Yeah.
But it was rock and rolling when I was there.
Yeah, when you were there, it was still hitting.
Yeah. It was legit.
Yeah.
It was definitely a violent place to live and work.
So, you know, for a certain kind of cop now, I don't know how much say you had in where you went, but like where I worked, my first department was a housing authority police in LA, right? And so I knew it wasn't like I was going to a large agency or even an agency in a city like Pasadena where there's some good parts and there's some not good parts and you don't know where you're going to end up. I knew that I was going to be working on the housing projects when I signed up for that job, right? Because that's what I wanted to do. To me, that was where I could learn the most. That's where I could get out there and really do what I felt the job of policing was all about, right? A lot of critical incidents, a lot of fast pace. So when you were there at the 8-3?
Yep.
And when it was rocking and rolling, like, did you come from another, like a slower precinct? I almost said division.
Yeah.
I'm going to get the hang
that's
of it.
All right. That's
did
all
you
right.
come from a slower precinct to go there, or you got rotated there because you pissed somebody off, or like how'd you end up over
no,
there?
No, actually it was a glutton for punishment. My buddy, Mike Quinn, who died of 9/11 illnesses post-9/11, great guy. He was the CO of the A3 at the time. And we were like a family friend tight.
Sure.
And I said, I want to work with Mike. I want to work in one of the, you know, one of the worst precincts in New York City.
Yeah, so you signed up for it, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, if you're well, into police and you want to do the, you do
like,
it right.
Like you went about it and like you had an insight from family and friends. Yeah. You want to learn.
Sure.
You want to learn, and
if,
that's how you survive.
If you're really about doing
And that's
that.
How you survive, too.
Yeah, if you're about doing there. This. If you just look at it as a job.
Yeah, and if you're looking for a paycheck.
Right. But
Staten
if you're really
Island.
About being the real police, you want to jump into the frying out of the frying pan into the fire.
You want to feel it.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's like exactly. When we're playing the major leagues, I'm not playing for the Brewers. I want to play for the Yankees. Yeah.
Right.
Play for the Dodgers. Right. Same thing for policing, in my opinion.
Sure. Anyway. You want to get out there and do your thing.
Yeah.
Sure. Yeah, absolutely, man. So you were here for the discussion on the decriminalization of marijuana. Now, what do you think that's looking like, and what impact would that have for law enforcement, do you think?
It's pretty much legalized in the city of L.A. right now, and California, you know, not on the books per se, but yeah, it is.
You're right. I mean, yeah, you drive on the way to Palm Springs, there's all these signs for all the marijuana places in Palm Springs, like billboards next to the freeway.
So I have a question, if I could ask him. Do they make arrests or no?
No, we try to avoid that at all costs because there's zero impact in the criminal justice system.
Right.
So unless it's some kind of citizen-driven complaints where we have a lot of these pop-up dispensaries that are unlicensed, like bootleg places.
Oh, okay. Well, that's different. That's money, taxation, illegal narcotic sales. But
yeah, if it's being a nuisance in the neighborhood, you know, it's bringing bad crowds.
It's still robberies. A dope house. It's still a dope house at that point because it's no regulation to it.
Right.
And it's
I'm going to give you what I would. My question is: you're driving down the highway, guy smoking a joint, he gets pulled over. Is anything happening to him?
No. I mean,
unless he's intoxicated, right?
He's driving on the highway. He's listening to music, you know.
If you got a couple, you know, if you got an ounce in your car, or whatever, you're smoking weed in public. We got bigger fish to fry.
Are they going to toss your car because you smell a joint? Is that
no?
The reason I ask that is because I wonder where policing is at.
Sure.
Like that's what I wonder because I can't walk anywhere. Never mind here, even in New York, without smelling it.
Absolutely.
And if I'm driving down the highway, it comes in my vents.
Right.
Oh, yeah.
Sure.
Every day.
Sure. And so, marijuana is a very unique smell. You know
when you
smell it. Sure.
Knows it's there.
Sure.
Is he looking for that car? Or, I mean, is he just wasting his time?
Well, the courts are even looking at it where if you smell marijuana, the scent of marijuana in the car, is that reasonable suspicion or probable cause to go further?
It used to be.
Of course.
Well, see a joint, a roach in the ashtray?
Yeah, it used to be PC all day long.
Yeah. So they're even looking at that. Now, if that's going to be something where people can get into someone's car, if that's going to be problem cause or not. So we're going into some interesting legal territory down the road.
Yeah,
no doubt about it. So what about, so how does that impact applicants? If it's not illegal anymore, are they screening applicants for marijuana use? If an in-service officer does do a drug screen, are they screening for marijuana at that point? Or like, is that an issue for
in guys service, on the job? It's still...
Somebody on the job right
it's
now.
It's still illegal. They're still testing for marijuana.
Now, how do they justify that when it's if it's legal? Legal.
Well,
what's the difference between that and beer legally?
Well, it's still controlled,
okay,
more or less, and it's a part of the contract. You know, this is a voluntary position. It's like you could smoke weed all day long.
Answered the question,
You know, it's like here, it's like
it could be contractual, right?
Yeah,
sure.
It's like certain fire departments, they can't use tobacco products.
Well, I was going to say that I had a friend who did that. He was applying to go to another police department, and he comes in one day. We're in detectives together. And he hands me his whole cigar humidor. And I go, what are you doing? He goes, I got to quit smoking. And he goes, at the very least, I got to get out of my house because my background investigator is coming over. I go, what does the background investigator care if you got cigars? He goes, because this agency is a non-tobacco agency.
Oh,
the city, for police and fire at least, I don't know about everybody else,
right.
No tobacco use. They don't want it. He goes, so I had to sign an affidavit.
Uh-huh.
It's something that will get you bounced out of backgrounds because they ask you when's the last time you did it.
Speaking of cigars, how was my cigars?
They're always good. They're always good. Always good. That's why I keep ordering them. They're always good. So he gave me a whole humidor. I still got it.
Yeah.
Well, you know, I don't have the cigars anymore. But I got the humidor.
You got some cigars the other day, though.
I do. I got
a
sweet,
right
I got a sweet
humidor.
Bonus. That's
okay,
right.
Okay.
Right. And
7.5 cigar, by the way.
I was going to say.
I'm not plugging them.
That's if you want a good smoke, man, 7.5 cigar. Yeah, they hit you up.
They hit me up on Instagram, Twitter. Just send me a message. And
real solid.
And it's a legit cigar. It's in a blunt.
Yeah.
Oh, it's a legit cigar. All right.
No spliffs.
You got one, didn't you?
It was good.
Yeah.
Cigar. Yeah. It'll get you lifted, but the legal way.
Yeah.
Right. Exactly. So yeah, I've heard of that. Where so I guess they could do that with marijuana. Then they can do it with tobacco.
Although it is getting normalized up in Canada, some agencies are allowed to use marijuana, but they can't use it like up to like 72 or 48 hours
before
to the shift.
Yeah.
So okay. Kind of be the same thing of alcohol. You can't
you can't show up drunk
before a shift.
So okay. Yeah. So and if I don't know how far we're gonna go on this topic, but so opioids, like you get injured on the job.
Right.
Can you get a prescription for marijuana?
You know, that's an interesting question.
I mean, that's what I...
Right.
You can get a prescription, but can use it? No. You know, if someone says, hey, this prescription...
So my doctor prescribed me marijuana instead of taking 12 opioid pills every day and getting hooked on opioids.
You're getting hooked on that, or then getting bounced for that. I knew an LAPD officer that I work with at the airport. She was having some back pain or something, and her husband, who I think was also on the job, had a prescription for like some sort of a painkiller.
Yeah,
right. Yep. So here, honey, take one of these.
Pissed her out.
So she takes one, gets called in for a piss test, random.
Yeah.
And it shows up. And they go, well, you got a prescription for this? She goes, no, but my husband does. Go, no.
It's a misdemeanor.
And they put her through the ringer. She almost lost her job behind that. Yeah.
Yeah, I mean.
Yeah.
And yeah,
so well, why not marijuana, though? If you got a prescription, why wouldn't they just be cool with it? So I can go get hydrocodone.
Right.
Or OxyContin.
Get
and that's fine.
Up. Yeah.
Right. But I can't go get some edibles or something.
Yeah.
But what you guys were saying before, it's going to be a generational thing. So the people that are getting phased out that through their career that came up in the 60s and what have you, and then my generation, as it gets normalized, we're going to be making the rules. And we're going to say, it's ridiculous.
It's ridiculous.
Listen,
back when I came on the job in the 80s, if you had ever tried cocaine, you were disqualified from ever being a police
officer. So I lied. No, that's not true. I actually never tried
it. You hadn't tried it first.
I actually never tried cocaine.
You hadn't tried it before.
Before I was a cop. Until I was 26 years old. Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah.
Well, it was if you had ever had it, you were done, right?
Right.
And then if you had marijuana like in the last 5 years, you were done.
Right.
Now, what is it, 6 months for marijuana and 2 years for cocaine or something like that, as long as you've got... that amount of time.
Well, I got that time clean right now. I could go for a job then.
There you go. Yeah, there you go. Give them a flyer. So
we defunded. Forget it.
I've got a lot of experience from both sides of the fence.
Right. Exactly. You met very fine people on both sides.
That's right.
Sure, right?
And still the best friends today.
Right. Yeah. So, you know, let me ask you this, man. I want to play this video on defunding the police. Because I see your shirt says proactive policing is not a crime.
Yes.
And not yet,
yeah,
right?
Well,
not yet.
I don't know
we'll
about
see.
That.
Well,
you know, and there we're gonna talk about no knock warrants in a future show, but right now there's an explanation on defunding the police, and we only have to give it about 2 minutes, producer Poetess, just to kind of break down some of the terms and then kind of get your opinion on that. We can kick that around.
Right.
Okay. So we can roll that whenever you are ready.
Defund the police is being put to mayors across the country, but it means different things depending on who you're asking. To some protesters, defund means disband. Minneapolis Mayor Jacob Frey was booed out of a protest after saying he does not support abolishing police. Some organizers don't go so far. They interpret defund literally, as in just spend less on a police presence and weapons and spend more on education and housing. These ideas have sparked a national debate, but here on Capitol Hill, the whole concept is viewed as a step too far. I just wanted to ask you about this idea of defunding the police. Is that something that you support?
I just don't believe in that as an answer, that you take money away from an essential department. It would have to be crippling to have an effect, and I do not want to cripple law enforcement. That's my answer.
Democrats introduced a bill this week on policing reform. Defunding the police is nowhere to be found. It does, however, ban chokeholds, make lynching a federal crime, restrict military weapon sales to police departments, and create a national database of police misconduct. Republicans have even indicated that they'd support some measures.
Well, there's some of the things in the Democratic bill that I could support, some I can't. I think the public would appreciate us trying to move the ball forward.
What about this ban on a chokehold, a database?
Sounds like a good one.
Okay.
Sounds like something would make sense, kind of a national registry of, you know, tracking how often does this occur. I think those things make perfect sense to me.
Despite the fact that this bill may have bipartisan support.
So in that video clip, they kind of got into defunding versus abolition. And I've been here on same spot on Jazz Mechanic Show where that's been the conversation. When there's some people who are straight up abolitionists who think we do not need police, which blows my mind because every human society on the history of this earth has had the equivalent of some sort of peacekeeping or policing force. Yeah. So to say that we don't need police is ridiculous. Yeah. I can understand if you say, hey, we want to look at it differently. We want to rethink it.
They tried it in Seattle.
Yeah, well, we saw how that, right? How long did that last? Right. It didn't go very good, right?
It didn't go very well.
You got to have police because people are knuckleheads. And right. And that's knuckleheads on every stripe. They're very fine knuckleheheads on both sides.
Yeah.
So
that nation changed its name three times.
Yeah, it did. Right? Chaz, Chop, something, right?
Well, you just break it down to like a family element. So that would be like saying parents couldn't enforce any rules within their house. And the kids are just going to do whatever the hell
they
want.
Imagine?
It's ridiculous. So, I mean, the police essentially are the parents of the neighborhood. Hey, don't do this. Don't do that. Hey, stop whatever. And if you're going to abolish that and take away the parental level on a neighborhood level, I mean, it's just madness.
Well, see, and that's the thing. And so people say, like we had a case called, it was a LaTosha Miller case happened in Riverside, California, back in the early 2000s and maybe even late 90s, where there's a young woman who was passed out asleep in her car. And she had a gun in her lap, okay? And so her loved ones went to wake her up, saw the gun, and said, okay, well, let's call the police. Police show up, some tactical errors were made, and she ends up being shot to death by the police. And everybody's like, oh, my God, why did the police do that? Well, you're her family members, and you didn't want to deal with her, right? You called the police because you felt this was something that was beyond your scope to be able to handle. Family member or not, you're still a civilian. There's only so much you can do.
Right.
So you called law enforcement out. And could they have done it better and different? Absolutely. I know one of the guys involved in that personally.
Maybe.
They absolutely, and he'll tell you, they could have done it
undoubtedly.
Different.
Undoubtedly.
They could have done it
undoubtedly.
Better. No doubt about it. Yeah. But you can't take that away, because then who are you going to call next time? You're going to get the neighborhood banker or the neighborhood shade tree mechanic to come out and deal with that?
Yeah.
Not going to work. You got to have somebody who's going to come deal with that. Now, if we look at, well, you know, if all you got's a hammer, then every problem looks like a nail. You know, so maybe we don't put such an emphasis on the use of force in policing, or lethal force at least, but we got to have some sort of apparatus to keep knuckleheads in line, because there are people who are just straight up career knuckleheads, and there's some people who just have knucklehead moments, and they, you know, and they got to know that the police are there to kind of keep them on a straight and narrow. That's just what it is.
Yeah, you want to improve the police.
Exactly.
And by defunding, what does that mean? That means you're not going to attract qualified applicants. Salaries are going to go down, and who's going to apply for these jobs?
Right, not the people you want to
have.
Lower
caliber people that are even worse than the people we have now.
And where have we seen this before? New Orleans, and it's one of my favorite cities. I go to New Orleans as often as I can. Believe me,
great town.
We love that town. New Orleans had a very low-paid police department at one point.
Yes,
and the corruption in New Orleans
was
rampant. Yeah. Like they probably made you guys look like choir boys over the 7-5.
They were
out of control. But they said that part of that's because of the low salary, right? And then you know when we talk about
they had hit squads.
Oh yeah, sure. when we're talking about
they were killing random, you know.
Well, you had an officer. You had an officer kill her own partner.
Yeah, right.
In New Orleans, right? Antoinette Frank, that whole situation.
Right.
Yeah.
But when we talk about people say things like, hey, we need to have police officers take psych exams every 5 years. You got to take a psych, right? Because you got to take one to get in, so why not take one to stay in, right?
Okay.
And this is what I tell people, okay, but who's going to pay for that? Because let me tell you why. Because I came on the job at 23.
Right.
Okay? And so now, 5 years later, I'm 28, and you
man.
Say, you got to go take that psych.
Yeah.
And now let's say I go take the psych and
I
don't pass. Well, clearly
pension.
It's because of this job.
Pension him out.
So now you're going to pension me out and pay my 28-year-old self for the rest of my life?
Tax-free.
Tax-free.
Yeah.
It's tax-free because it's a disability.
Right.
Do you want to pension me out and pay a
28-year-old
for the rest of his natural life?
This is the dilemma.
You know what I mean? That's why they're not going to do it. So there's a different ways to do it.
Well, do you think that most police officers would fail?
No, because they would have to adjust it, just like they adjust a background investigation for laterals versus somebody coming from McDonald's or something.
Right. So I don't think it would be as bad as that. There may be the
extreme. It would purposely not be that bad because they don't want to start cutting those checks.
They would fix it. So as a 20-year-old taking the psychological test,
right,
opposed to a 25 or 28-year-old, you would see the world differently, right?
Absolutely.
I mean, my first job was basically a clam boat. I ran a clam boat. I dug clams. My next, essentially, besides
that's some East Coast shit, right?
Yeah, I dug clam. I worked in a liquor store, right? I robbed that. No, I worked in a liquor store. I loaded my house with liquor, and then I switched over to clamming. All right, so
clamming.
Yeah, I
became a word for it.
I was a bay clammer. All right, and so
some real Billy Joel shit.
Yeah,
right there.
So, there you go.
Yeah,
you
I was
go.
Billy Joel. He's I mean, Long Island kid. I'm gonna cry. Don't do that. So then I went to the police department. So. What did I know?
Right. What kind of life experience did you have versus 5 years
yeah.
later?
Yeah. So now at 25, I'm certainly going to feel quite a bit differently about. See, but you know, but asking me if I like flowers six different ways.
Right. That's
you know,
what they do.
Yeah.
Right.
That's not the question that they should be asking me at 25. Right. And I've now been a seasoned cop in a ghetto. Excuse my French.
Sure.
For 5 or 6, 5 years. You know, that's a different. That's a different animal, right? That's
yeah,
a
different absolutely.
Human being than the 20-year-old kid who's deciding whether he should stay in his accounting class.
Right.
And become an accountant.
Or become a police officer.
Go make some real money. Or go. I'll go become a police officer.
Right.
So.
Yeah. No. Absolutely, man. So, you know, without naming names or whatever, in your agency, what are the thoughts? Like, are there people who do feel like maybe we need to rethink this? Or are there people like, or is everybody like, screw that, don't defund anything?
Well, it's we're seeing the ramifications very quickly. It almost happened overnight of
right.
this knee-jerk,
all this
basically
all this
knee-jerk
has.
Reaction.
Yeah.
So what you're seeing is, particularly on the investigation side of the house where I live, is... say homicide investigations. Usually that was carte blanche for overtime because it's so
sure.
complex,
sure.
especially gang homicides. And so now that we're under the gun for overtime, because the budget got decreased,
right.
investigations are going to decrease.
Sure.
So what happens when you have investigations decrease, the state of apprehension grows longer.
So the
right.
guy who did the murder is now in the street longer.
Yeah, he's in the street
right.
longer.
Possibly
right.
murdering his neighbor because he doesn't want to get caught.
Which we're seeing right now. In this division where we live, not where we live,
where
we're doing the studio,
right yeah.
Homicides are up 25% compared to last year. And
that's crazy.
So
and
I'm not necessarily
And that's not
suffering.
A thing that you can play with stats. It's not like what well, people just aren't reporting
yeah,
murders it. Murders. Everybody reports a murder.
Yeah.
A murder's a murder.
Right.
Yeah, you're just not playing
right.
with stats
yeah.
with a homicide.
Yeah, right.
Yeah.
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 So it's not necessarily hurting me as much, but the people that live here, I mean, feeling
being
hard.
Impacted, sure.
And, you know, obviously us, violence against police officers is gone through the
it's
roof
gone
as well.
Sure.
There's
so
no respect.
It's that and there's no backing from city governments right,
right
now. So
right. It's, right. it's got to be terrible. I mean, you know.
Well, I'm glad I'm retired.
Yeah.
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 yeah. I mean,
you
it's
know,
a
hands
good...
on a cop back in the days when
man,
I went yeah. through, the guy was going probably to hospital. And not necessarily decapitated or anything, but they were. You know, if you touch a police officer,
right.
that's a, first of all, it's a crime. Even
sure.
today, it's still a
it's
crime.
Still a crime,
but it's not looked at that way.
Yeah, there was,
and
there was
and
consequences
it's okay
and repercussions.
To spit at a cop, or smack a cop, or point your finger at a cop and go like this. You know,
right?
I'm gonna kill you.
No, we had consequences and repercussions. You did that back in the day.
Yeah,
like for real, for real. So you know, one of the things they talked about in this thing we just saw was like limiting the use of the chokehold. And a lot of agencies done that anyway. In L.A., we did away with the chokehold, except it's a lethal force option, 30 years ago. Like 30 years ago,
yeah.
they you know,
get,
the city of L.A. got to
yeah.
get away from the chokehold,
okay.
right?
Yeah.
So these are things.
What do you replace
like
the chokehold with? I mean, that may be the only
there's thing. There's other upper body control holds you can use that
okay.
don't involve like a carotid hold, like a chokehold,
okay.
you know?
Okay.
So there's ways
to do that.
It's been
a while
for
me. So
but here's the other thing, too. And we're looking at this from the perspective of big city police.
Right.
There are police departments in this country where you don't even have to go to the academy until you've been on the streets for a year, sometimes 2 years. In like middle America, what we call flyover country.
Right, right, right.
You know, there's police departments, sheriff's departments where you come up on your 2 years, there's Zeb, you got to go to the academy now.
Oh, really?
And then the guy will go to the academy, but he's been a cop for 2 years already. It's like, what are you doing? What?
Yeah.
Now, he's been with a training officer for however long.
Right, right.
But it ain't the same as all the knowledge they stuff into your head in the academy.
Right.
And just the respect for the procedure, as opposed to raise your right hand,
right.
go cut your hair, put that uniform on, jump in the car.
Right.
I can't imagine that. But there's definitely a need for a nationwide standard. Because when you have that kind of thing going on, you can't tell me that those people are getting the same quality of policing that people in the larger areas.
I would have thought it was. I would never have known that.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Yeah.
I would never have known. I mean, I know there's little different levels, but I would have assumed that every police officer was fully trained.
See, you were on a job and don't know that.
Right.
And
right.
People across America don't know that. Right. That's kind of law enforcement's dirty little secret is
right.
How much training or how little training we get.
So
and it varies.
And the thing with chokeholds is I'm a jiu-jitsu practitioner and we choke people out every day. I get choked and I'll choke people out and nothing happens.
Right.
And what it is, of course, I'm trained in it. I know how to do it.
Well, you're trained in it. You're fit. You don't have all kind of drugs on board. All the stuff that somebody in the street, you know what I mean, may or may not. And you're trained well in it, too. So you may have an officer who's not trained to apply it properly.
That's the problem.
And right. And a suspect who's not going to come out of it because he's got other conditions.
Right. Which you don't know. Or
which you don't know, which you can't possibly know.
You can't be that guy.
You can't possibly know.
He might be on something else, so I can't do this, you know, if I need to protect my life. Or
that's the thing. It's the lack of training, and which leads to the misapplication of force. And if you haven't been thrust into a violent conflict before, which a lot of people haven't,
right.
Especially
right.
Kids growing up now where everything's about anti-bullying
yeah, sure.
And people are at home.
Yeah. Sure.
So when they're in that on the street in a Donnybrook, they're going to go to the gun faster
right.
Than...
Because they haven't been hit in the face before.
They don't know it's like
yeah.
Punched.
Yeah, I was just getting punched and rolling around just a couple hours ago. And now
yeah,
I'm here at work.
It.
I'm like,
yeah.
All right, whatever. I got this. I could hold on. I could, even
sure.
If the guy's bigger than me, I'm
right.
Cool under pressure.
You know how to put your body in the right position to not be taken advantage of. Well, and one of the biggest things about people don't understand, unless, of course, you are a police officer, is your gun is your biggest problem. Your
yeah.
Gun is your
you
biggest
gotta
threat.
Protect that
your
gun
is
sure.
Your biggest threat.
Sure.
And that's how I always looked at it. You know?
Yeah, it's a liability.
My gun is going to kill me.
Three out of every seven police officers who were shot in the line of duty are shot with their own guns.
Well,
that's why
that
when they issue you a vest.
That was always my fear.
When they issue you a vest, I'm sorry, it's 4 out of 7. When they issue you a vest, the vest has to be rated to stop your issue handgun.
Right.
That's why.
Right. Right.
Okay.
And from friendly fire.
And from that too.
That's not so friendly.
That too.
Yeah.
That too.
Yeah, Serpico. I mean, no.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So, and I know we're getting close on time here, so I don't want to.
Is there anything that we should elicit from him being he's?
So, if you had to tell somebody who was thinking about a career in law enforcement, right now, what would you tell that person who's working at McDonnell Douglas or is a paralegal or teaching school? I knew a lot of cops who were teachers.
Yes.
We're teaching school and thinking about making a leap to law enforcement. As a current law enforcement supervisor, what would you tell that person?
If you want to do the job for the real true reasons of doing the job is you want to protect people, you love interacting with the public, you do want to make your community safer, go for it. It's a challenging job, no doubt, but it's a great job, very satisfying. If you're going in for it for the benefits and the pay and what have you, you're going to be miserable for 20 or 30 years, and then you're going to make me miserable because I got to supervise you.
Right, right, exactly.
So don't do it.
Yeah.
Right, don't come. Don't be a cancer.
But yeah. Don't listen to the people that the naysayers of, oh, it's a horrible job. My grandfather was on the job, great-grandfather, uncle, and every generation has said that.
Yeah, sure.
Policemen are usually a glum lot,
yeah.
And they're just from seeing things over and over, tragedies and all that. They have a misshaped view of the world.
Sure.
But listen to the people that have survived and are doing it right and get their opinion, which I want to say might be me. And
right.
It's a very satisfying job, but
sure.
It's very tough. So be sure you're going into it for the right reasons,
the right reasons.
And you'll love it.
Okay. Before we get out of here, social media. You got social media that you want
yeah,
people
you know,
to follow
on? Instagram, The Mike Dowd, Twitter, The Mike Dowd as well, and Facebook, Michael Dowd, you know.
Okay. Did you have any social media you wanted to put out? Or
yeah, Twitter and Instagram, at Knocko, or just Google Knocko Nolan.
That's at Knocko. That's cool.
Yeah.
It's easy to remember.
Yeah, if you've got questions, hit me up, whatever. Hate mail, fan mail, shoot me a message. I'll
respond. I get it all. You scumbag.
Yep.
You were never a cop.
There's a...
yeah,
there's a
we're our harshest critics, police department.
Oh yeah, absolutely.
That's what people don't realize.
Yeah,
we're harder on each other
ruthless.
Than the public ever will be.
Ruthless.
That's one message. Maybe we can get into it in another show. I'd like to talk about.
Oh yeah, for sure.
Yeah,
yeah. Yes. Well, we got them coming up for sure.
Yeah.
So you can like us on Facebook. It's Ride Along Radio Show, and you can follow us on Instagram. It's at Ride Along Radio Show, or on Twitter, and it's just Ride Along Radio. So we're going to be more active on social media than we have been because we're back in the saddle and back rolling. And I'm hoping that we get a good long stretch here, and we reach
on,
a whole
buddy.
New audience.
It's on. Let's go.
It's on. It's on and cracking, as they say. So until then, I am George Holt,
and Mike Dowd,
and
our guest
Knocko Nolan,
our esteemed guest Knocko Nolan, here on the Ride Along Radio Show. So we will catch you guys the next time here on the Ride Along Radio Show. Thanks for joining us.